The next morning, Rick's ankle bothers him, so Kathleen drives him to the hospital.
They saw us pretty quickly. They took a look at Rick's leg and did an x-ray.
They'd seen an old injury in there that showed up on the x-ray. And they ended up putting my leg in an air cast. The doctor wasn't really concerned. He said, I don't really see anything that wrong.
The doctors give Rick painkillers, and the couple return to the house to continue their holiday.
We were sitting around for dinner on Saturday night, and he was on the couch.
One of the kids just kind of looked at him and said, Dad, are you all right?
He was a gray color. The blood in his body was not flowing like it should. He literally looked like a corpse.
And the first thing that came to anybody's mind was, is he having a heart attack?
That's when fear really struck everyone in the family.
Kathleen calls an ambulance, and paramedics transport Rick back to hospital.
I remember them putting the blood pressure cuff on. My blood pressure was almost non-existent.
They were concerned that it was a heart attack.
So doctors run more tests. The results reveal something else.
It wasn't a heart attack. His body was in septic shock.
This is a condition that occurs when a body-wide infection leads to dangerously low blood pressure. In up to 50% of cases, it's fatal.
My body was under attack. You could feel your whole system shutting down. And then a sphere, a very golden sphere, came through and sat right here on my left side. I don't know what it was, but there was no doubt in my mind I was right on the edge of death. None. I was there. And the nurse kept popping me and saying, stay with us. Don't go.
With Rick wavering in and out of consciousness, doctors transfer him to another hospital. There, infectious disease specialist Dr. Mary Eshte takes on his case.
When I went to see Rick, I was very concerned that he may not survive his admission to the hospital. Rick's body was shutting down one organ system at a time.
Doctors put Rick on numerous medication and also removed the temporary cast from his leg.
I found this ankle, which looked very, very inflamed.
His ankle was really gross. It was swollen, it was bruised, but it was turning black.
When I looked at it, I knew that it wasn't sprained. I knew that it was infected.
Dr. Eshte takes a sample of the tissue from Rick's infected ankle, and the cultures reveal the cause of his condition.
Rick's infection was caused by Vibrio vulnificus.
That was a shock.
What in the world is this?
Vibrio vulnificus is a flesh-eating bacteria. Inside Rick's body, the Vibrio bacteria latch onto the tissues in his ankle. There, they multiply and cause his flesh to rot. As the infection grows, it disrupts the flow of blood to his vital organs, leading to his pale color, low blood pressure, and septic shock.
We were shocked and confused. This can't be happening. We had no idea of the implications of this bacteria.
Vibrio vulnificus is one of the deadliest bacteria known to science. What makes Vibrio vulnificus bacteria so potent is their ability to release chemicals which inhibit an immune response. The bacteria can kill their hosts in as little as 24 hours. And those who do survive are often left with life-altering disabilities.
I do remember the doctor saying, there's a very good chance I'm going to have to amputate. And I said, doctor, I'm a soccer coach. It's how I make my living.
For several hours, doctors cut the dead flesh from Rick's infected leg.
You use a scalpel to cut away the dead tissue. The surgeon takes thin cuts until they get to an area that bleeds. And that's what determines whether or not it's viable. When doctors do debridement, they cut until they get to an area that produces blood. You need blood supply. So if it's not bleeding, it's not viable. No blood supply, you die. Debridement means going in and removing all the dead tissue. It means taking out non-living tissue. It means you use a scalpel or whatever else you need to cut away the dead tissue. This is not a guarantee there aren't any microorganisms, but it does at least show you that there is a blood supply to that area so that the antibodies can get to that area to work.
In the recovery room, Rick slowly awakens from the anesthesia.
I remember trying to fight off the drugs that they used to put you under. And I remember trying to get my hand to move and go down my leg to try and feel to see if it was still there. And I remember the nurse coming over to me and checking on me. And she said, it's okay, it's still there. But my leg was hideous to look at. Bone was exposed, tendon, ligaments. Pretty cool.
After his surgery, Rick's long road to recovery begins.
I had 7 surgeries in 2 weeks.
I didn't see it until after the 3rd surgery. And when I saw it, I almost got sick. It was awful looking. And he was in a tremendous amount of pain.
It was like looking at a raw piece of meat in a butcher's shop, but it was still there.
Finally, we were able to tell Rick and his wife that he was going to make it, although we thought that he still faced a long period of rehabilitation. We knew that he was going to be able to keep his leg. We knew that he was going to have scarring, but felt that after proper rehabilitation, he would be able to resume all of his prior activities. We felt great that we could finally announce that he was free from infection, and it looked like his leg was on the road to mending. The team felt that this was a victory and that we saved this person's life and his leg.